Hello, I'm Akinori Hosoyamada from NTT Secure Platform Laboratories and Nagoya University. This is a talk on dedicated quantum collision attacks on concrete hash functions. This is a joint work with Yu Sasaki. Recently, many public key schemes that use hash functions are proven to be post-quantum secure. In those proofs, existing hash functions such as SHA-2 and SHA-3 are expected to be secure against quantum superposition attacks. That is, those proofs use the quantum random oracle model. To estimate security of a concrete primitive, we have to study dedicated attacks on it. However, there seems few study on dedicated quantum attacks on concrete hash functions. So, let's study dedicated quantum attacks on hash. This is the motivation of our research. Suppose that there is a concrete hash function capital H. It is widely believed that if this hash function H is secure in the classical setting, then it will also be secure in the quantum setting. This is a common belief on security of hash functions. However, our result demonstrates that this common belief does not necessarily hold. Next, I will explain the background of classical collision attacks. Let H be a concrete hash function with output length n. Then, the classical generic collision attack finds a collision of H with time complexity 2 to the power n over 2. So, in the classical setting, a dedicated collision attack on H is considered to be valid only if its time complexity is less than 2 to the power n over 2. Usually, we consider differential cryptanalysis to find collisions of concrete hash functions, and build a differential trail such that non-zero input difference delta in can propagate to zero output difference delta out with a high probability. Typically, the differential trails for hash functions have two parts. The first part is the controlled part, where a complex trail is efficiently satisfied by using degrees of freedom. And the second part is the uncontrolled part, which just satisfies the trail probabilistically. Usually, the controlled part is satisfied with negligible cost. So, the attack complexity T is mostly dominated by the trail probability P of the uncontrolled part. That is, T is equal to 1 over P. So, in the classical setting, a dedicated collision attack on a concrete hash function based on differential cryptanalysis is considered to be valid if and only if the differential probability P is greater than 2 to the power minus n over 2. Next, I will explain about generic quantum collision attacks. In our paper, we consider three quantum settings depending on available computational resources. In the first setting, we assume that a small quantum computer of a polynomial size plus large quantum RAM of exponential size is available. In this setting, the best quantum collision attack is BHT algorithm, which finds a collision with time 2 to the power n over 3 by using a quantum RAM of size 2 to the power n over 3. This setting is theoretically very simple. However, it is not clear whether such a large quantum RAM will be realizable in some future. And usually, quantum memory is quite expensive. So, we also consider other quantum settings. In the second setting, we assume that the efficiency of a quantum algorithm is measured by time-space trade-off, and quantum computer of size S and classical memory of size S are available. In this setting, the best quantum collision attack is the classical parallel law method, which gives the trade-off T is equal to 2 to the power n over 2 over S, as observed by Bernstein. Here, we assume that the unit of space is equal to the space required to implement the target primitive. so that the complexity analysis will be independent of the implementation of the primitive. In the third quantum setting, we assume that a small quantum computer of polynomial size and a large classical memory of exponential size are available. In this setting, the best quantum collision attack is the algorithm by CNS, which finds a collision in time 2 to the power 2 n over 5 by using the classical memory of size 2 to the power n over 5. We consider these three quantum settings, and we consider whether a dedicated quantum collision attack is faster than the generic attack in each setting. Next, I will explain an observation on quantum differential cryptanalysis. Kaplan et al. Observed that if there exist differences delta x and delta y with differential probability p, we can find a message x that satisfies the differences in time the square root of 1 over p with quantum computers. In the classical setting, we have to spend time 1 over p. In the classical setting. So, with quantum computers, we can obtain a quadratic speed up for differential cryptanalysis compared to classical differential cryptanalysis. Here, we observed that there exists a gap between the speed up for generic collision attacks and the speed up for differential cryptanalysis. For generic collision attacks, the speed up with quantum computers is always less than quadratic. On the other hand, for differential cryptanalysis, the speedup is quadratic. So, after seeing this situation, we came up with this idea. Quantum differential cryptanalysis may break more rounds than classical ones. Recall that in the classical setting, a differential cryptanalysis-based attack is considered to be valid if and only if its differential probability p is greater than the birthday bound. Now, in the first quantum setting, a differential cryptanalysis-based attack is considered to be valid if and only if its attack time complexity, the square root of 1 over p, is less than the complexity of the BHT algorithm, 2 to the power n over 3. And this is equivalent to the condition that the probability p is greater than 2 to the power minus 2 n over 3. So, in this setting, we can use smaller probability than the birthday bound. Similarly, in the second quantum setting, a differential cryptanalysis-based attack is valid if and only if the attack requires size s and the time complexity, the square root of 1 over p, is less than 2 to the power n over 2 over s. And this is equivalent to the condition that the differential probability p is greater than s square times 2 to the power minus n. And here, note that if size s is very small, then the differential probability p can be very close to 2 to the power minus n. Similarly, in the third quantum setting, the condition for the differential probability p changes, and now the condition is p is greater than 2 to the power minus 4n over 5. So, again, we can use smaller probability than the birthday bound in this setting. In summary, the condition for the differential probability changes depending on the settings like this. Actually, this analysis is very rough because here I'm ignoring the cost of the controlled part. Later, when I will explain about our dedicated quantum attacks, I will also explain details on the cost of the controlled part. This analysis is very rough, but we can obtain the next very important observations. First, differential probabilities that were smaller than the birthday bound cannot be used in the classical setting, but may be used in the quantum settings. And even if a hash function is secure in the classical setting, if there exists a differential trial with probability in between 2 to the power minus n over 2 and 2 to the power minus 2 n over 3, it may be broken in the quantum settings. We developed dedicated quantum attacks based on these observations. our quantum attacks are quantum versions of the classical rebound attack. So next, I will explain about the classical rebound attack. The rebound attack is an attack technique for AES-like permutations, such as AES and Whirlpool, based on differential cryptanalysis. Often, concrete hash functions are defined like the hash value of a message M is equal to message M plus E of M. Here, E is a block cipher, like AES. And the goal of the rebound attack is to find message pair M and M prime such that the difference of messages is equal to the difference of ciphertexts. If we find such message pair, then this gives a collision for H. And the rebound attack divides the cipher into three parts, the first outer part, inner part, and the second outer part. The rebound attack assumes that there exists a differential trail like this. There exists truncated differential delta x and truncated differential delta y. That propagates to another truncated differential delta 0 with probability p1 and probability p2. And the difference delta 0 exactly matches with probability p0. Here, the differential probability of this trail is p1 times p2 times p0. Based on this assumption, the rebound attack works like this. First, we fix difference delta x and delta y. Then, we compute x, x prime, and y prime that satisfies the differential. This phase is called the inbound phase. And next, we compute m, c, m prime, and c prime. And finally, we check if the difference of messages is equal to the difference of ciphertexts. This equation holds with probability p0 times p1 times p2. So, if we try this procedure 1 over p out times by changing the difference delta x and the difference delta y, we will obtain a message pair m and m prime that satisfies this equation. This is how the rebound attack works. For example, this is the differential trail used in the classical rebound attack on 6 round AES. The differential probability is 2 to the power minus 56. The rebound attack is valid in the classical setting because the differential probability is greater than the birthday bound, 2 to the power minus 64. For the inbound phase, we use a technique which is called super S-box technique. Here, I don't explain details, but the important point is this technique requires a memory of size 2 to the power 32 in the classical setting. Next, I will explain our new attacks. Recall that the classical rebound attack procedure looks like this. We repeat this procedure for 1 over p out times. In our attacks, we use a quantum version of the rebound attack. By using the global search, the number of repetition decreases to the square root of 1 over p out. We developed quantum attacks on reduced round versions of AES-MMO and Whirlpool. AES-MMO is a hash function standardized by Zigbee and previously by IETF. The output length is 128. Whirlpool is a hash function recommended by NESHI and standardized by ISO-ICE. The output length is 512. In the classical setting, the best collision attacks are 6 rounds for AES-MMO and 5 rounds for Whirlpool. In our paper, our attack targets are 7 round AES-MMO and 6 round Whirlpool. Recall that the classical trail for 6 round AES looks like this. Now, this is the new trail we found for 7 round AES. The differential probability is 2 to the power minus 80, which is too small to be used in the classical setting. However, the probability is still greater than 2 to the power minus 2 over 3 times 128. So we can use this trail in the quantum setting with QRAM. Next, suppose that we are in the quantum setting with time-space trade-off. Then, we also have to care about the space complexity of the attack. Now, suppose that the inbound phase can be done with average time complexity x with space complexity s. Then, the total time complexity of our attack becomes x times the square root of 1 over p, which is equal to x times 2 to the power 40. So, our attack is valid with respect to time-space trade-off only if x times 2 to the power 40 is less than 2 to the power 64 over s. And here, we call that in the classical setting, the inbound phase uses space complexity of 2 to the power 32. However, in the quantum setting of time-space trade-off, if we use such large memory, the attack becomes invalid. So, we have to change the inbound phase. So here, we use the global search to find the value of the super S box, instead of using large memory of size 2 to the power 32. Then, the average cost to find the solution x becomes about 2 to the power 16, but the space complexity becomes negligible. And the total time complexity of our attack becomes 2 to the power 56, and the generic attack complexity becomes about 2 to the power 64. So, our attack becomes valid in the quantum setting of time-space trade-off. This is a summary of rebound attacks on 7-round AES MMO. In the classical setting, our differential trail is invalid because the differential probability is too small to be used in the classical setting. In the first quantum setting, where a small quantum computer of polynomial size and large quantum RAM of exponential size are available, a precise analysis shows that the time complexity of our attack becomes 2 to the power 41 or 2 to the power 42, which is just slightly lower than the generic attack complexity. Nevertheless, our attack is valid in this setting. In the second quantum setting of time-space trade-off, a precise analysis shows that the time complexity of our attack becomes 2 to the power 59.5 over the square root of s over 2 to the power 3. When we have a large quantum computer, we can decrease the time complexity by parallelizing the global search. Our attack is valid if the size s is in between 2 to the power 3 and 2 to the power 6. Finally, in the third quantum setting, where a small quantum computer and a large classical memory is available, our attack becomes invalid. Next, I explain about attacks on Whirlpool. This is the classical trail used in the classical rebound attack on 5-round Whirlpool. The differential probability is 2 to the power minus 120, and the inbound phase or inner part consists of 2 rounds. And in the quantum setting, we change this differential trail like this. Now, the outer part and the differential probability is the same as classical ones. However, now the inbound phase or inner part consists of 3 rounds. The 3-round inbound phase requires time complexity 2 to the power 160, but it requires negligible quantum space. And the total time complexity of the attack becomes 2 to the power 220. Now, 2 to the power 220 is bigger than 2 to the power 1/3 times 512. So, this attack is, unfortunately, invalid in the quantum setting of QRAM. However, the space complexity S is relatively small, so this attack is valid in the quantum setting of time-space trade-off. For 3-round inbound phase, again, we use a memory-less variant of a classical technique. I don't explain details, but in the previous technique, we have to do some pre-computations which requires space of 2 to the power 64. However, in the quantum setting, we cannot use or we do not want to use such large quantum memory. So, in the quantum setting, instead of doing such precomputation, we just run the global search. This increases the time complexity by the factor of 2 to the power 32, but the global search requires negligible memory. By using such memoryless variant, our attack becomes valid in the quantum setting of time-space trade-off. This is a summary on rebound attacks on 6-round whirlpool. In the classical setting and in the first quantum setting of small quantum computer and large quantum RAM, our attack is invalid. However, in the second quantum setting of time-space trade-off, our attack becomes valid. A precise analysis shows that when a quantum computer of size S is available, the time complexity of our attack becomes 2 to the power 228 over the square root of S over 2 to the power 8. Our attack is valid if S is in between 2 to the power 8 and 2 to the power 48. Finally, in the third quantum setting of small quantum computer plus large classical memory, our attack becomes invalid. Concluding remarks. We showed that classically secure does not imply quantumly secure, and differential trails with too small probability in the classical setting can still be meaningful for quantum computers. And we improved collision rounds for AES MMO and Whirlpool. And finally, I want to claim that differential trail search should not stop with probability birthday bound, but should consider up to 2 to the power minus 2n over 3 or more. We should revisit differential trail search activities, because there will be many differential trails that cannot be used in the classical setting but can be used in the quantum settings. That's all. Thank you for your attention.